baseball says goodbye to the regular season. The Cubs get salutations by saying so long, ball, for a new playoff record. Detroit says howdy to an early playoff lead to make the Royals start off saying see you later. Several teams bid adieu to former managers and declare how do you do to brand new ones. One Yankee gets greetings for gallant hitting, while another says sayonara to a batting crowd. An angel says good day to history with a perfect ending for a good night to the season. Baseball bids farewell to one commissioner and welcomes another. And we'll say hi and bye to it all on This Week in Baseball. This Week in Baseball is brought to you. Kansas City lined up against Detroit for the American League Championship Series, and the Royals dropped Game 1 largely because of Alan Trammell's blistering bat. Trammell wasted no time giving the Tigers a lead with a first-inning triple that drove home the game winner. His numbers for the opener? 3 for 3 with 3 RBIs, including a home run. 1 of 3 for the Tigers that led to an easy 8-1 victory. The winning pitcher, Jack Morris, a master on the mound, striking out 4 in 7 innings and giving up just 1 extra base hit. Kansas City skipper Dick Houser watched helplessly as counterpart Sparky Anderson called on reliever supreme Willie Hernandez to slam the door. And that he did with 2 perfect innings. It took the Tigers 11 innings to win the next game 5-3, and they went home to Detroit just 1 win away from the pennant. It was a heavenly night in Oakland when Kansas City clinched the Western Division. George Brett started the Royals off right with a home run, number 13 this year. Frank White was also just right, going 3 for 5 and driving in 3, including home run number 17. The charge to the crown was supported on the mound by Dan Quisenberry, who got save number 44 to top the league and put Kansas City atop the West, the Royals' 5th division title in 9 years. In mid-July, Kansas City was 10 games under 500 and in 6th place, but then went 44-25 to clinch it. Man, what a comeback.
This team was buried from spring training on, and it was resurrected tonight, and it's proven to people that with a great organization such as the Royals, you can come back.
Yes, sir, a battle royal. Hardly anybody counted Kansas City to be in the swim this year, but the Royals never discounted themselves. They hung tough and came on strong to surprise everybody. And for Kansas City fans, it was almost paradise.
I thought that dreams belonged to other men. 'Cause each time I got close, they fall apart again. And all these dreams I save for rainy days, they're finally coming true.
Joe Morgan has played his final game. A certain Hall of Famer, Morgan retired after 22 big league seasons, the last with Oakland. Good teams always seem to follow Morgan around. He was with the Phillies last year when they went to the World Series, and with San Francisco in 1982 when they were in the race until season's end. Morgan was a key member of the Astros when Houston won the National League West in 1980. But he'll best be remembered for his 8 seasons with Cincinnati. The spark plug and accelerator of the big red machine, Morgan won back-to-back MVP awards in 75 and 76 when Cincinnati won back-to-back championships. He's the all-time home run leader among second basemen. But now it's time to say goodbye to Little Joe.
Just say goodbye to Little Joe. Just turn her loose now, let her go. And she'll be leaving while the sun goes down. Just say goodbye to Little Joe. Just say goodbye to Little Joe. Just say goodbye to Little Joe.
And now, let's open the notebook for this week in baseball's TWIB notes from around the American League. Boston's Ralph Houk has retired after 19 years as skipper of the Yankees, Tigers, and Red Sox, winning more than 1,600 games and 2 World Series. In Milwaukee, Rene Latchman was dismissed as manager of the Brewers and replaced by former Mets skipper George Bamberger, Bambi's second time around in Milwaukee, having managed there from 1978 to 1980. New York Yankee Don Mattingly won the league batting title over teammate Dave Winfield on the final day of the season, going 4-for-5 against Detroit to finish at 343. Winfield went 1-for-4 to end at 340. Less than 1 percentage point separated the two when the day began, so hats off to both. Baltimore's Mike Boddicker beat Boston on the next to last day of the season to become the only 20-game winner in the league. He also led the league in ERA at 2.79. His 11 losses included 3 straight to start the season. Now, it's time for this week's Volkswagen quiz, brought to you by the 1984 models. It's not a car. It's a Volkswagen. Among this year's 4 division winners, the Kansas City Royals had the weakest regular season record at 84-78. The division winner with the best record this season was Detroit, 104-58. Now, for this week's quiz, can you name the division winner that finished with the most victories since division play began in 1969? And the one with the least wins? Stay tuned for 2 World Series losers.
In the 1940s,
in Chicago, action at the plate for the National League Championship Series, where Mr. Cub, Ernie Banks, was in uniform to provide inspiration. It must have worked, because in Game 1, Bob Dernier slammed the second pitch into the seats to give the Cubs the only run they needed against the Padres, although they scored 12 more just for insurance. Matthews provided 4 of those runs with 2 homers, among the Cubs' 5 in a 16-hit attack, both championship series records. Matthews was last year's playoff MVP with the Phillies, and old Sarge was in charge again. Even pitcher Rick Sutcliffe played long ball, and he hadn't homered all year. For the Padres, it was look out. Cub bats were booming, and the Wrigley wind was blowing.
Just coming here, and I think Bob Dernier set the stage for us early in the ball game. They made it that much better. The wind was really blowing out hard just about all day. And when we're swinging the bats good, I tell you, we're a tough ball team to beat.
Especially with Sutcliffe on the mound. 8 strikeouts in 7 innings for win number 15 in a row. The only Padre threat was nipped in the third by Keith Moreland, who made the defensive play of the game with 2 out and the bases loaded. From then on, it was smooth sailing for the Cinderella Cubs, who again won the next day to take firm command as the series moved on to San Diego. Chuck Tanner's Pittsburgh Pirates finished last in the National League East, but the pitching staff finished first in the league with an ERA of 3.11, the first time that's ever happened. One member of the staff is Don Robinson, who had an unusual final day of the season. In game one of a doubleheader against the Phillies, he struck out the side in the ninth inning to notch his 10th save. Then in the nightcap, which the Pirates also won, Robinson played left field and went 1-for-3 with an RBI. How about that? St. Louis pitcher Joaquin Andujar became the only National League 20-game winner this year, finishing at 20-14. The Cubs' Rick Sutcliffe won 20, but his first four were with Cleveland. Bruce Sutter came on to save Andujar's 20th, giving Sutter 45 saves, tying the big league record set last year by Kansas City's Dan Quisenberry. Sutter had a chance to break the mark on the last day in Chicago, but gave up two runs in the ninth and lost the game. New York Met rookie Dwight Gooden ended the season at 17-9, striking out an average of 11.4 batters per game to set a major league record. That broke the mark of Cleveland's Sam McDowell, who averaged 10.96 strikeouts per game in 1965. 19-year-old Gooden led the majors in strikeouts with 276, while Seattle rookie Mark Langston topped the American League with 204, the first time that rookies have led each league in strikeouts in the same season. Now, let's review this week in baseball's TWIB notes from around the National League. The Phillies' Paul Owens resigned as manager and returned to the front office. He assumed the job last July and guided the team to the World Series. He was replaced by John Felsky, his top assistant. In Atlanta, Joe Torre was dismissed as manager after 3 years in which he skippered the Braves to 2 second-place finishes and a Western Division crown in 1982. The team tapped 30-year employee Eddie Haas to take over. 23-year-old Juan Samuel of Philadelphia set a rookie record for steals with 72, breaking the mark of 71 set by Montreal's Tim Raines in 1981. Samuel was second in the league this year to Raines, who stole 75. Sam, well done. Fans, baseball really lost a legend when Walter Alston passed away recently at age 72. In 23 years as manager of the Brooklyn and Los Angeles Dodgers, Alston led the team to 7 pennants and 4 championships. With 2,040 victories and a .558 winning percentage, Alston was elected to the Hall of Fame last year. Now, let's get into the answer of this week's Volkswagen quiz. The New York Mets took the National League East in 1973 with the worst record ever by a division winner at 83-79. They beat Cincinnati for the pennant, but lost the series to Oakland in 7 games. Baltimore won the American League East in 1969 with the best record by a division winner, 109-53. And after beating Minnesota for the pennant, the O's went on to lose the series in 5 games to the amazing Mets. What a win! Hey, fans, hold on just a minute. Let's take time out for an eyeful of Foul Ups Afield. Can get so frustrated, but then so can the fans, because it's not always easy to grab hold of that ball. sometimes you just gotta laugh. Otherwise, you might become all unraveled. Maybe even lose your mind. Enough already. We're at the end. And I do mean the end. Time now to start up some head-spinning performances. Defensive rocking and rolling that is picture-perfect. Nothing but hi-hat play. Up first, Texas Ranger Wayne Tolleson. A pair of White Sox, Scott Fletcher and Ron Kittle. San Francisco's Brad Wellman. Teammate Rob Deere. Jim Rice, Boston Red Sox. Minnesota's Ron Washington. New York Yankee Joe Cowley and a sweet scoop by Don Mattingly. Baltimore's Rich Dower. Oriole Encore, Rick Dempsey to Mike Boddicker. Boston's Bill Buckner. Teammate Jackie Gutierrez. Kansas City's Frank White holding on. Houston's Jose Cruz. Milwaukee's Rick Manning. Cincinnati's barehanding Pete Rose. Ed Amelung, an L.A. artful dodger. And the Red Sox, Tony Armas. After 16 years as commissioner of baseball, Bowie Kuhn stepped down. Only the fifth commissioner in the game's history, Kuhn always upheld the high principles of the office.
I think the commissioner's responsibility is basically one of conscience. I still feel that most people in baseball recognize that it is one of conscience. And if you look back over the years where I have made decisions which have a particular application to the player-management relations, I think you'll find that I've been very even-handed in my approach to it.
Case in point, former Oakland owner Charlie Finley, who sold Raleigh Fingers, Vita Blue, and Joe Rudy for $2.5 million in 76. Commissioner Kuhn voided the sales because they went against baseball's best interests.
What Finley didn't know was that the commissioners over the years had frequently stepped in and said this kind of an assignment of players is okay or isn't okay for a variety of reasons. We presented a very compelling history that from Landis right on up through Frick, commissioners had indeed stepped in to different kinds of situations, said yes or no.
Commissioner Kuhn presided over significant rules changes, including the American League's use of the designated hitter.
You can change your playing rules in football, you can change your playing rules in basketball, and everybody says, hey, that's good, that's progressive. You change anything in baseball and everybody screams. Designated hitter is a very good example. There's tremendous opposition to the designated hitter. You're not supposed to change baseball. It's the holy of holies. The rules are not to be changed.
One change implemented by Kuhn is the playing of World Series games at night, making the series available to millions more fans.
We looked at the possibility of playing World Series at night because we thought it would enlarge the audience. It would be a promotion for the game. Because it worked. It worked tremendously well.
Baseball worked tremendously well under Kuhn, setting new attendance records, maintaining its place as the national pastime. And it should work just as well under new commissioner Peter Ueberroth. Gentlemen, best of luck to you both. A few weeks ago, we told you about the production of this year's World Series program cover. And now we're back for a look at the finished product painted by artist Sheila Wolk.
I'm very pleased. There were slight problems, the aging process between the old tintype photograph and the today image, the part where Reagan looks alive. Outside of that, it's been a lot of fun.
The original painting will hang in baseball's Hall of Fame. And now it's time for an Old Spice salute, brought to you by 24-hour strong Old Spice deodorant and antiperspirant. This week, Old Spice salutes Mike Witt of the California Angels. On the final day of the season, the 24-year-old right-hander tossed a perfect game against Texas. Only the 13th perfect game in big league history. Witt struck out 10 along the way for the first nine-inning perfect game since May of 1981, when Cleveland's Len Barker beat Toronto. What a way to end the season.
I struck out 16 against Seattle this year, and I would compare it to that. I don't know. I had a good breaking ball today, and they were swinging at and missing, but comparable, it would be comparable to that game.
Witt stepped out to pitch the ninth inning with the weight of the world on his shoulders. But he easily set down the first two batters on a strikeout and a ground ball before facing pinch hitter Marv Foley. And there it is, pitching perfection. Witt's second shutout and ninth complete game this year, giving him a season record of 15-11.
Well, all I was going for today was 15. I wanted that really bad, but as the game went on, I knew I had a no-hitter. I didn't know about the perfect game until later, but that's a great feeling. I really don't know what to say right now. It's so soon afterwards. Maybe tomorrow it'll sink in or something.
We're with you, Mike. And that's all for now, folks. See you next week on This Week in Baseball.
Comes in a new fresh scent.